Hello and welcome to Build. I'm Ash Percival and we are coming to you live from London, this very cold Tuesday afternoon. Now, if you're anything like me and you love playing armchair detective in front of a grisly crime drama, you'll know that Marcella is already back on our screens. And today we are joined by two of the stars of the show who are hopefully going to shed a little bit of light on the case that's unfolding. Please welcome Nicholas Pinnock and Yolanda Kettle. Of course, if you've got a question for these guys, or maybe you want to send in some bribes for some spoilers, I know we're open to taking those. You can tweet us. We are at BuildSeriesLDN on Twitter. And of course, if you're watching via Facebook or on the app, you can also submit your questions there too. Now, guys, hello. Welcome to Build. How are you both?
Very well, thank you.
Hi.
Yeah, good. Now, obviously, first series of Marcella was absolutely huge. And we're two episodes into the second. And already, like, people are talking. People want to know stuff. How have you found the reception so far?
I only really know from like my family and my my friends, because I'm not on social media, so I don't really know. So, but my parents watching it, my dad's like, what's going on? What's going to happen? Because he loved series one and so did I, because we're real sort of crime drama fans in our family.
It's a matter of time before you started being stopped in the street and accosted in the supermarket, I think. I guess that's probably your experience from the first series, right?
Yeah, that kind of happens yeah. from time to time.
People are just desperate for answers, aren't they? And this series as well, it's kind of taken quite a dark turn quite early on. The case that Marcella and her team are investigating, it involves sort of child paedophilia, child killings. How does it sort of compare maybe to the first, if people have watched the first series, how would you market this second series to them?
It's definitely a gear change, you know, in a darker direction, because, you know, the first one was really, it was thrilling, it was confusing, it was one of those dramas you really had to use your head for. And I think, I just feel the creators thought, well, you know, what are we going to do? How are we going to top that? Because it was such a success last time, thankfully. And they came up with this storyline that just seemed to go and go and go and go and go. And they've really made it a bit darker and given the audience something else
very
to
sinister.
Sort of hang on to, yeah.
I mean, within the first few moments, we're seeing a child that's, you know, been found dead inside the cavity of a wall. Was there sort of a feeling on set when you started filming that, gosh, this is sort of a lot darker than the first time round?
I think certainly Anna felt it. And there was, you know, we were all really, really aware of it, but it's that odd thing when you're doing something that's super dark, actually the camaraderie and the atmosphere off set and in the makeup truck and costume is just so joyful and everyone's really sort of pulling together and having a laugh. I suppose it's that kind of thing about having a respite away from the actual, you know, the horrendousness of the program itself.
I guess you need that, right?
And reading through the scripts, you know, you could tell that it was just, it was so different. And we were all coming and going, oh my God, have you read episode four? I'm like, you know, just, you know, going on and on. Because they were page turners, so we were communicating with each other as to how, you know, enthralling they were. And it's one of those things, if we're excited about it, we hope the audience are going to be as well.
And this is obviously your first series. We saw you make your first appearance in the first episode. You played Becky, who is Jason's new fiancé.
Yeah, very
lucky. What was it about the show that really sort of attracted you to the part?
I loved series one. I loved it. I was such a big fan. So it was kind of just a no-brainer, really. Mm. And it's a really weird thing when you take a role in a project like this, because you, like as Nicholas was just saying, you don't get released the scripts. They come as they're written from hands, which is also just an incredible way of working. Slightly
terrifying.
So I kind of joined it going, I have no idea what's going to pan out for Becky or what's going to happen. But I was so thrilled to be part of such an incredible drama. And also I feel like it celebrates the diversity of British actors and actresses. Mm. And I think that's hugely important. And I'm really proud of that as well.
You're also thrown into the deep end quite early on, because within moments of making your debut, Anna Friel is throwing you out of a car and attacking you.
Yes.
What was that scene like to film?
So much fun. Although, so I was
told... I'm guessing you didn't know each other actually that well at that
point,
right?
No, we didn't. Like, it was really, really early on. And we had no kind of real stunt rehearsals. And we had stunt doubles. But the stunt guy was like, come on, girls, you can do it, you can do it. So Anna and I did this scene. I mean, by the end of it, we were just both completely knackered, and I was sort of just like slightly shaking and feeling very strange. But it was really fun.
I guess it's just fun to go for it as well, isn't it? Just no holding just back, just get stuck car. In. Yeah. Now, I want to rewind to sort of the end of series one a little bit, because we had a lot of questions at the end of series one that were kind of left unanswered, shall we say. Series two, we're two episodes in now, as I say. We've not kind of found out maybe some of the answers to some of those questions just yet. I know there will be a lot of people in the room and a lot of people watching at home that want to know when we're going to find out the answers to some of those questions. Or maybe we won't, will we?
Will we? some of the things at the end of series one that weren't wrapped up will be looked at in this series. Some of them may not be.
Did you sign up knowing that we weren't necessarily going to get the answer straight away?
Yeah.
Was that kind of, when the scripts landed on your doorstep, were you kind of just like scrabbling through them to find out?
Right, this is the thing. We only get them as we go along.
Right, okay.
So we film in blocks. So we film the first three episodes, then we film the next three, and then we film the last two.
Right.
We only get them as the blocks start filming. So no one knows who the killer is. No one knows what's going to happen, where your storyline's going to go. You just have it in chunks. And that's quite... I've never worked... I mean, most of the actors on the show have never worked like that before, so it's quite nerve-wracking. But it's also quite interesting because you have no idea how... Normally what happens is you get everything all at once and you kind of map out how you're going to play certain things and, you know, have that big reveal or whatever. In this, we were completely blind, so we just had to trust and go with what was on the page.
And as a viewer, were you convinced that Marcello was a killer? Because that's really what we're still waiting to find out, isn't it? You know?
I really couldn't bring myself to believe it. Because despite the fact that Marcello is so sort of, you know, slightly off the wall and a bit of a rogue detective.
It's one way of describing it.
I did really warm to her. I suppose just because I just loved seeing such a strong female at the helm of an amazing programme. And so I just kind of... I know it's dubious, isn't it? And it's not clear.
Did your perceptions change once you joined the show? Did you think, I didn't spot that when I was watching it as a viewer, and I think this slightly differently?
Yeah, I've realised that he is not such a great person. In real life, I adore you. But Jason Backlund is, you know, that I think that will seep out a little bit.
He's a shady man, Jason Backlund.
Isn't he?
He's got a lot of secrets.
He's a misguided individual.
Did you have your own theory about Marcello during series one? I know, obviously, you will probably know the outcome now by the end of series two, but did you, during series one, were you convinced either way if she had killed Grace or...?
We had kind of like a loose bet in the green room as to who it might be, but every day it changed. Mm. Because every script that came through and every time we filmed a scene, there were things that came out. We thought, oh, maybe it's you. No, we think it's you. Oh, actually, I think it's me. And we had no idea whatsoever, which, you know, it really kept us on our toes. I spotted the killer.
Who was Henry, right?
Who was Henry,
for those who can't recall.
I think about episode six or episode five, when we were reading through, I thought, oh, I think it's him. And I stuck to my guns and I was right.
And it paid off. Were you the only one that got it right?
I'd like to say yes. Yeah.
We'd have to ask the rest of the cast if that's true, yeah. I suppose. Now, obviously, if we do find out that Marcella is a killer, and she did, you know, kill Grace, as was kind of alluded to at the end of series one, how do you think Jason would react? Because obviously that was his lover. She was pregnant with his child. How do you think that he would react to that news?
That's a difficult one, because I have a theory about Jason.
Right.
I think Jason and Marcella are still in love.
See, that actually was my next question, because I kind of agree with you.
Yeah, right.
No, I think at the moment she loves him. I mean, obviously, Becky. You guys are desperately in love. You're obviously planning a wedding, but I feel there's unresolved business there.
I think there's unresolved business there as well. I can't confirm that. Honestly, I can't confirm that. But I think there's unresolved business there.
Well, actually, in episode 3, which we've actually got a clip of now, things do take a turn for Jason and Marcella when she's dealt a bit of a blow from him. Let's take a look.
I've been offered a new position in Singapore.
Right.
2 years to start with.
Well, you obviously can't take it, can you?
I've already accepted. I fly over the day after tomorrow to look at apartments. The whole family will be coming with me, Becky and the kids.
Oh, no, they won't.
Now, you're going to give me sole custody of the children.
Are you out of your mind?
I'll be gone for the next 2 weeks. When I return, these need to have been signed. Otherwise, I'll tell everyone about your blackouts, and you'll lose both your job and the kids.
Ooh. So she's got a lot to think about in next week's episode. After that, I can't see any way back for them, but I guess that's the beauty of Marcella, is there's so many twists and turns and there's so many red herrings throughout the show. How wary should we be for those red herrings? Because I know that people that have watched the first series know that that's a huge part of the show.
I say very. Yes. Hans is amazing in the way he writes. You'll have one character come in for one scene and say one line, and you won't see him again until maybe episode, like, you know, 7. And that will be of significance. So he throws these things in, and you think that, oh, that was just one person saying one line, they don't mean anything. And then they have a really big reveal later on. So there are loads of red herrings, and you will go down every single path because you will believe that you are right. But that won't be the case.
How, sort of when you did get your scripts through, did you fall for the traps as you were going along and obviously reading it in those block by block stages?
Yeah, of course. Of course you do, because you read them through and you go, well, it's definitely him. Or it's definitely so. And then you start to get on set and you start acting it, and then you read the next episode, and you're completely wrong.
What's kind of like the wildest theories that you've heard so far? Have you had many in? Have you had some that have come in, obviously via social, or via family, or?
It was a hamster.
I know. Well, the mouse. The scene with the mouse was pretty dark on last night's episode. That was a way to finish the show, shall we say. And Edward is going to prove to be one to watch, I'm guessing. But obviously, he's been through quite a lot. He's watched his parents split up, his best friend has disappeared and been murdered. Is that going to have a more lasting effect on him than we maybe originally thought?
I think quite possibly. I mean, clearly these are huge events for such a young kid to experience. And so I think it would... it'd be foolish not to explore that, and to give time to that, because, yeah, he's confronted with all of, this news about Leo that had sort of been buried in the past and now sort of resurfaces, and they've just started a new school as well. They've just moved to the local comprehensive school, so there's a lot of things changing, particularly for Edward, and I think that will sort of unfold as the episodes go along.
And the young actors in this series especially, they're just so brilliant, aren't
they?
What were they all like to work with?
I love them.
They're amazing.
Because also they're dealing with some quite sort of tough themes and topics as well. It's not just, they're going to shoot a sort of a day at school. It's dealing with quite hard-hitting, gritty stuff, I suppose.
They really take it in their stride. They're so mature, incredibly mature. And then offset, we're just always laughing. Always laughing, having a joke, having a great time. They're unbelievable people.
Yeah, they're so much fun to work with. And so, we've seen them, well, I've seen them grow from series one to series two, and they're so much more grown up now. And, their approach to how they, deal with themselves on set is, that much sharper, and, their work is better. So, If we go ahead next year, they're just going to keep getting better and better and better, and we're going to have to watch our backs.
Yeah, they'll be coming for your jobs. Obviously, as we said, Hans released the scripts in blocks, but obviously you filmed the series now, so you kind of know what the outcome is. What kind of lengths do you have to go to keep that secret up?
Just can't say anything. Can't say anything at all.
Just sworn to secrecy. Do you have to like literally sign your life away after you've finished?
I think we might sign. I can't remember. Probably.
Well, you know, we've done this before, and how much didn't I tell you?
we've had this pretty much exact chat before, yeah. And I got nothing out of him then.
Nothing.
I hoped this time would be different, but alas. Do you get many sort of bribes and propositions from people, sort of encouraging you to spill stuff?
Not enough. I'm open to them. So if anybody wants to bribe or proposition me, let's see what happens.
You can catch him outside the studio after, everyone. I'm sure he'll be receptive to that. Obviously, we mentioned, the topics are quite harrowing and can be quite controversial. And obviously, it is a bit more sort of on that edge of side of stuff than maybe the first series was. Were you sort of a bit more prepared for controversy surrounding the series this time around compared to last time?
Yeah, I mean, we were reading the scripts and you kind of know that it's going to get the attention in the controversial manner because it's just dealing with things that people find uncomfortable to watch. Mm. So, some of the viewers have said that, this is very uncomfortable, or not sure, I don't know what's going on, and this is a bit dark, but I love it, I'm going to watch it anyway. So people are kind of, they're aware of the fact that it's going to be a darker journey for them this time. But we have an audience that still want to continue to watch, and, we hope they do, because it will be worth it.
And I guess as well, this is reflecting an issue that is real. This kind of stuff does happen.
Yeah,
so
we can't shy away from the fact that these things do happen. And we're telling a story. Mm. We're telling a fictionalized version of real events. And we're dramatizing it to actually create this thing called a TV drama.
Yeah.
So it's just part and parcel with what we do. We take it in our stride. And we think there's an audience out there now that are prepared for it.
Mm. We've had a question come in via the app. This one is from Tom Reed. Hello, thanks for your question. He says he loves Han Rosenfeld's work, but were you guys a fan of his before Marcella? Did you watch The Bridge, for example?
Watched The Bridge, was a fan, loved it.
Easy answer.
There you go, Tom.
Yolanda, how about you?
Ditto.
We've had another one come in as well. This is from Bobby Hang on Facebook. He says he's loving series two, but are there any other TV dramas that you would love to be a part of?
So many.
Yeah, so many.
Oh my gosh, there's so many.
The Walking Dead.
Oh.
I'd love to be just put me in a zombie costume, walk past. That'd be enough. Power. I like that. Wouldn't mind being in that.
I like The Handmaid's Tale. I thought that was amazing.
So good.
Loads of things. What else?
There's obviously, you've already ticked The Crown off your list. So.
Yeah, I mean, I'd love to be in that again. That was great.
How did working on Marcella compare to that experience? Because obviously it's quite
completely
a different.
It's completely different because The Crown is
sort
of this.
Say ours was better.
I'm saying they're different.
Say Marcella better.
I loved Marcella so much that on the last day, I just cried and cried and cried after they said cut. Genuinely, it's like one of my favourite jobs I've ever done. And it's funny, because despite all of the darkness, there's just complete enjoyment. The scale of The Crown, the thing with The Crown is like it's costumes and it's all the hair and all the makeup and, you're playing essentially real people. And so there's a load of history there and there's that kind of background research and work on your accent, whereas this is really just about personal relationships, about your objectives and playing with those people that you're in the scene with, which I love. Especially with him.
We're nearly out of time, but I know that I will get lynched if I don't ask this question. We know obviously we don't know how this series is going to end, but if there's a potential for series three, would you both come back?
I would love to!
Absolutely.
Okay, I'm taking that as there's going to be a series three. Okay, that's fine. Sadly, that is all we've got time for, but we should just say that Marcella airs Mondays at 9 p.m. on ITV. And if you've missed any episodes or want to catch up on series one, it's all available now on the ITV Hub for you. I'm off to now try and prize more spoilers out of these guys backstage. But don't forget that we are back here at 2:30 when comedian Chris Ramsey will be here in the studio, so don't miss that. In the meantime, please give it up, everyone, for Nicholas Pinnock and Yolanda Kettle.